Welcome. Welcome to First Baptist Church, located at 190 Main Street in Brattleboro, Vermont. We are so glad that you've joined us this morning to worship with us. We are handicapped accessible. We have a wonderful Sunday school program. And all of you are welcome to come and worship here. If you need a ride, please call the church office at 802-254-9566, and one of us would be happy to come and pick you up. But again, welcome to the worship of the Lord.
Is from the book of Matthew. This is chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. And this is the Sermon on the Mount. Well, Jesus saw all the crowds, and he went up a hill, and he sat down. And his disciples gathered all around him, and he began to teach them. And this is entitled True Happiness. Happy are those who know that they are spiritually poor, because the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. And happy are those who mourn, because God will comfort them. Happy are the meek. They will receive what God has promised. And happy are those whose greatest desire is to do what God requires, and God will satisfy them fully. Happy are those who show mercy to others. God will show mercy to them. Happy are the pure in heart, because they will see God. Happy are those who work for peace among men, and God will call them his sons. And happy are those who suffer persecution because they do what God requires. The kingdom of heaven belongs to them. And then Jesus said, happy are you when men insult you and mistreat you and tell all kinds of evil lies against you, because you are my followers. Rejoice and be glad, because a great reward is kept for you in heaven. And this is how men mistreated the prophets who lived before you. This ends the scripture readings for this morning. Happy are those who work for peace. Say that with me. Happy are those who work for peace. God will call them his children. We live in a broken world, don't we? We live in a broken world, and something has gone terribly wrong. People are angry with one another. They are angry and suspicious of people who do not look like them, who do not worship like they do, who belong to another denomination, who do not live in the same country or voted for the other candidate than we did, because what's going on politically leaves us all scared. Am I right? We are vulnerable. And we are allowing our vulnerability to take us places where we never dream of going. Fear. We have become afraid. Guns and knives have infiltrated our schools. And innocent children have been shot and killed. A bomber maimed healthy athletes at the Boston Marathon and left some crippled for life. A gunman opens fire on an unsuspecting crowd in a nightclub or at a mall. And sadly, these senseless acts of cruelty and horror are happening all the world over. And this reminds me of something we should never forget. And that's what happened to our nation on September 11th, 2001. We were attacked by a foreign country, a foreign people, and our lives changed forever. We learned new words. Terrorism, ISIS, suicide bombers. And we were introduced to a world of violence and fear. Do you remember where you were on 9/11? I do. My husband, John, had just died from lung cancer on September 5th. On 9/11, I was getting ready to leave for seminary when my next door neighbor calls screaming into the phone, "We're under attack! Our country is at war! Turn on your TV!" I ran to the TV, turned on my television, and all three major networks broke from their usual programs. I watched a live video feed of one of the Twin Towers with smoke billowing out of the windows, and horror took place of what had just been another beautiful morning in America. And we asked ourselves, how could this happen? This must be some kind of a mistake. This has to be something less serious than it looks. After all, we live in America. Well, at first, of course, no one could figure out what was going on. And it was approximately 8:50 in the morning, almost 9 o'clock, and the news anchors were speaking to folks on the phone who had seen what they described as a small commuter plane crash into one of the World Trade Center buildings. Well, there was no talk of terrorism right away, just bewilderment. Could there have been a problem with the air traffic control? We wondered. Had the plane lost control? Surely, this was just a terrible accident. A mistake. And as the reporters were speaking, and as more and more Americans were starting to watch their televisions, a few minutes after 9 in the morning, another plane, and this time it was clear that this second plane was a good-sized jet, and it slammed into the other tower. People screamed, and the people on TV went silent for a moment. And then Charlie Gibson on ABC began to talk for the first time about this being no accident. America was under attack. Thousands of lives were on the line. New York City was in chaos. We didn't know yet that another plane would soon hit the Pentagon, and another plane would be headed for Washington, D.C., maybe even the White House. But that plane would crash into a field in Pennsylvania after a heroic group of passengers rushed the cockpit. But another thing we didn't know is that September 11th would become a day that would change our lives forever. We lost our innocence that day, and we learned a new name, Osama bin Laden. We also lost a lot of freedom that we had taken for granted. We became less trustful of others, especially of people who looked different and dressed different from us. After 9/11, we became a scared nation, an angry nation. And for the past 16 years, we have been experiencing the different stages of grief. And sadly, The fifth and final stage of grief is acceptance that this is the new normal and that things will never be the same again. Now, I know those of you who know me. I don't like to preach on this stuff. I love to preach about love and kindness and compassion, but sometimes we need to hear the messages that God has for us. And it is my duty as your pastor to bring this to you. So we think things will never be the same again. Wrong. Because we have Jesus. And through Jesus, we have hope. And we will continue to work for peace. The Beatitudes that I just read to you teach us, happy are those who work for peace. God will call them his children. We are the children of God. And it is our job as Christians to work for peace, no matter how huge the obstacles we face. It is our duty as Christians to never give up and always strive to make our world a better place. Sure, we can never replace what has been taken away from us, but we can make the world a better place, not only for ourselves, but for those who follow us in this life. We can be a part of what God is doing, and that is creating a new heaven and a new earth where things will be restored to the way things were originally meant to be. Now, despite our fear, despite our concerns, these are exciting times. And let us not be depressed or ever give up. Let us not be angry. Instead, let us go to the Lord, and he will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his path. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote in The Cost of Discipleship that the followers of Jesus have been called to peace. And when Jesus called them, they found their peace, for he is their peace. But now they are told that they must not only have peace, but make it. This is the end of the quote. As peacemakers, are we supposed to look the other way and pretend things aren't happening in the world? As peacemakers, are we supposed to stand up for what we believe in? Defend anyone you see being hurt, or criticized, or bullied? We are all peacemakers, and as Christians, God wants us, and we need to accept the fact that we will do whatever we need to do to create peace in our world. Jesus says we are to feed our enemies. We are to love those who hate us, clothe those who have done nothing for us, provide food for those who ask, and spread the fire of love throughout our community and our land. And in doing this together, we are working toward a new future, a future that is not like the past that we have endured. Terrorism cannot hurt us. Our future is living out the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And this is what we need to pray for and be witness to. We need together to proclaim the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, to proclaim that he is bigger than any horrible catastrophe that could claim us and make us afraid. As Christians, we need to proclaim that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ is bigger than any terrorist, bigger than any hate, and much bigger than any evil. Because we are talking about the Savior who changes water into wine, the Savior who raises from the dead, the Savior who befriends the friendless and touches the untouchables. We are talking about the God who takes something as horrible as a cross used for execution and turns it into a symbol of eternal life. On September 11th, and in the years since, we have seen, we have felt, and we have experienced the most dreadful evil imaginable. So what are we as Christians to do? In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus tells us what to do. Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Now we know we can't do this on our own. But if we are to be the children of God, then we are to be his peacemakers. And I know we can't do that on our own. But I do know we can make a difference. And there's only way that we can do that, by calling upon God, by asking God to teach us forgiveness. And through forgiveness, we will be granted the strength to bring goodness and peace into the world. Carrying around hatred in our hearts is a horrible burden, a burden which makes us vulnerable, vulnerable to follow anyone who promises us easy solutions, revenge, hatred, and war. But guess what? Hatred does not satisfy. Hatred just leaves us empty, lost, and in a bigger mess than we were before. We learned this from 9/11. Hatred breeds hatred. Revenge breeds revenge. Violence brings on more violence. But love breeds love. Compassion breeds compassion. Forgiveness breeds forgiveness. Because forgiveness, on the other hand, forgiveness brings us freedom and opens the door to reconciliation and ultimately peace with the person who hurt us. The prophet Isaiah talks about a day when people will rely on one thing, God. And in doing so, when we come to rely on God, we will trade in our weapons of war for instruments of peace. That is our job. That is our mission. Peace, love, mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. And you know what? If Jesus can forgive me, who am I to withhold my forgiveness towards somebody else? When Jesus was hanging on the cross in utter humiliation and agony, do you remember his prayer? He prayed, "Father, forgive them. Forgive them, for they know not what they do." With Jesus' dying breath, he was asking God to forgive those who would not believe, to forgive those who persecuted him, who ridiculed and scorned him. And instead of hatred, our Lord Jesus asked God to forgive. And God expects us to do the same. The terrorists acted out of ignorance and unbelief. And we are called to do what can only be done through the Spirit of the living and loving God who lives in our lives, and that is to share that love with others. We need to listen and live by the words of Jesus on the cross, "Father, forgive them." And then we need to pray, "Father, forgive us. Father, help us to keep on, even when the going gets too tough. Father, enable us to believe in your mercy and your love. Father, help us to accept your mercy and your love. And Father, give us your peace so that we can go out and share your peace with others." In today's world, we are faced with all kinds of challenges, aren't we? And some days we don't know where to turn. Some of you live minute to minute, hour to hour, day to day. Rely on the greatness of God, because God is real and God can be trusted. And trust me, what the Bible tells us is one day there will no longer be war. There will come a day when the reasons for envy and greed, resentment, retribution, and fear will go away. The world will be converted through our faith, from learning war to learning about the ways of God. And we, as the body of Christ on this earth, are called to do everything we can to promote peace. Because through Jesus Christ, we can change fear into love. We can change lunacy into sanity and enemies into friends. Jesus died surrounded by swords. A spear stabbed him. Nails tore at his flesh. But the spears and the nails entered infinite love. And that infinite love melted those instruments of torture into light. And we need to enter the light that Jesus offers. We need to allow the infinite love of God found through Jesus melt away the darkness of our anger and our pain and our defensiveness, melt away our hatred, our violence, our prejudice, and turn these emotions into the light and the peace of Christ. Jesus called us to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Jesus called us to be the peacemakers. And trust me, if there are enough peacemakers, we will overcome evil and darkness, and we will change the sadness and fear that we face every day into light. Because our future is bright. So become a peacemaker with me. Turn the other cheek. Love your enemies. And you will become the peacemakers of our world. And then through you, the world as we know it will become a better place, not only for us, but for our children, our grandchildren, and our great-grandchildren. And we will not only make their world a better place, we will become happy. Because we will be working for peace. For peace. And when we do that, God will call us His children. God bless you all. Amen. Please join me in our communion hymn, number 335. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. 335, please rise if you are able.
And he said, take and drink. This is my blood shed
for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts through Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as together we proclaim the mystery of faith. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to one another. Heavenly Father, we ask your blessing upon this meal from which we are about to receive. Amen.
disciples, and he said, "Take and drink. This is my blood shed for the forgiveness of all of your sins. I want you to do this in memory of me. Amen."
Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves to others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
It's our custom to sing the first verse of "Blessed Be the Tie That Binds." So if you want to try to make a circle, we could, or you could stay where you are.
Amen.